In this video, we'll once again compare TCP and UDP, focusing on throughput. Thanks to the PR I received a few days ago, I was able to increase TCP and UDP throughput by 10 times. I think this is the best result you can achieve by using standard Linux API. In case it's not enough for you, you can bypass the kernel and interact with a network card directly, which is very common in high-frequency trading systems, and I'll cover it in the future as well. First, let's talk about payload. I'm using JSON message that I sent from the server to the client and counting how many of these messages I send and receive each second. Now, JSON is not suited for high-performance applications, but that doesn't really matter for my test. Let me explain why. JSON includes a schema with keys and data as values within a single object. Each character is 1 byte or 8 bits. So the entire JSON message, if you remove all the spaces, is 85 bytes. The keys alone account for 22 bytes, and if we include the quotes as JSON requires, it becomes 30 bytes, which is around 35% of the overall size of the message. When we send multiple messages to the client, duplicating those keys each time wastes 35% of the space. If we remove the overhead, we can convert that 35% of the message size into 35 increase in throughput. To solve this, you can use one of many binary formats, such as RPC. In this case, you would define the schema with all your keys separately and use it to serialize the message. For example, the exact same JSON message can be serialized using RPC, and instead of 85 bytes, we would get 38 bytes. So in this case, we only need to send 38 bytes over the wire to the client, which is basically half the size of the JSON message. This means we can double the throughput just by switching from JSON to RPC. In my case, I use arbitrary payload message size of 85 bytes. The most important part is that I use exact same message for both TCP and UDP, and I don't even parse JSON. You can think of it as just a text that I sent to the client. I don't use RPC because it would require adding additional libraries and make examples more complex without providing any significant benefit for my test. Now, when we work with low-level networking libraries, we need to understand what the maximum transmission unit MTU is. It is the largest size of the data packet in bytes that can be transmitted over a network in a single transaction without being fragmented. If you're sending data over the internet, you need to expect MTU size of 1500 bytes, which is the standard for WAN networks. But it's not fixed. You can change it in your local networks. For example, in AWS or GCP VPC, you can pick any size you like. There are some considerations for the size. A smaller MTU size can potentially reduce latency. For example, TCP buffers some of your messages by default and sends them out together in a single 1500 byte fragment. So reducing the size will decrease latency, but reduce throughput as well. On the other hand, you can use larger MTU values, such as jumbo frames, which are around 9000 bytes. The larger size allows more data to be transmitted in a single frame, reducing the overhead associated with fragmentation and reassembly. Some use cases include video and audio streaming, and maybe data backups. However, when considering a larger size, keep in mind that if the entire 9000 byte packet gets corrupted, you need to resend the whole fragment. The same can happen with 1500 byte MTU, but there is less data to be retransmitted. Now, let's talk about my mistakes and optimizations. Let's start with TCP. As I said before, I used a JSON message of 85 bytes, which I sent to the client using send system call. I also use default 1500 byte MTU. In practice, if we remove headers, the safe payload size is 1432 bytes of actual data we can transmit in a single transaction. In my test, each time I used the send function with my message over TCP, the kernel would buffer all those messages together until they reach the MTU size and then sends them in a single packet to the client. You can disable this behavior by setting TCP no delay. But even in that case, we have 1432 byte buffer, and to fill it with 85 byte messages, we need to make around 16 send system calls. So the first optimization is to combine those messages ahead of time and then make a single send system call, which would significantly reduce the overhead. In my example, on the client side, I used the receive function with a buffer sized to hold only a single message. So even if we send 16 messages in a single fragment, we still need to make 16 receive system calls on the client side, which again increases overhead. To fix this, we can simply use a buffer that holds the entire fragment, allowing us to read it from the buffer in a single shot. On UDP side, it's very similar, but there is no delay whatsoever when we send a UDP message. To improve UDP throughput, we can apply similar logic, fill the entire buffer, and then send it in a single system call. This would improve throughput, but of course, it will increase latency as well. So it's a trade-off you need to make for yourself. For the first try, I'll use M7A medium instances in AWS for servers and clients. Alright, first let me run the test in AWS using a non-optimized version of my source code, where I make all unnecessary system calls and do not buffer UDP messages. This time, I don't gradually scale TCP and UDP load. Instead, I try to send as much data as I can from the start. You can notice exactly the same results as in the previous test. UDP reached around 420 messages per second, and TCP was able to manage more than a million messages per second. Well, UDP does have lower latency, but it loses to TCP in throughput due to better congestion control in the TCP protocol. Now, let me restart the test and run optimized versions for both TCP and UDP. This time, UDP could reach 6.5 million messages and TCP around 7.5 million messages per second. Well, if you take a look at the network throughput, you might notice that TCP hit the network limit and could not transmit more than 5 gigabits per second, while UDP looks like it does not have this problem. From the CPU graph, you can see that UDP has full utilization when the TCP server and client are at around 60 and 70%. So my guess was that without that AWS network limit, TCP could potentially achieve 30% more throughput. Well, based on the official documentation, these EC2 instances should provide up to 12.5 gigabits per second of network bandwidth. I got only 5 gigabits out of 12.5. So I thought, well, let's try something bigger, and even thought they say M7A large instances have the same network bandwidth. I was hoping that it would be higher than 5 gigabits per second. I updated my infrastructure and replaced medium instances with large instances, and I rerun the test. Well, since I have single-threaded applications, the maximum CPU usage could only be 50%, since these instances have two CPUs. But the same problem remained. I still had 5 gigabits per second limit. Well, the next viable option without the limit is to use 8 extra large. But I decided to finish this test using my home lab. It's based on AMD EPYC processor, and I use VMware to create my virtual machines. I also create the same 4 instances, but keep in mind, my server is just a little bit slower than M7A instance types, so you'll see slightly lower numbers. First, we have the same non-optimized versions, which reach 330,000 and million for TCP. So this is the same as in the previous test. Next, let me finally run optimized version without the network becoming a bottleneck. As you can see, TCP reaches around 10 million and UDP slightly less than at BS, 3.5 million messages per second. And as you can see, TCP transmits more than 6 gigabits per second. So this would conclude my test. TCP has higher throughput due to congestion control, and UDP has lower latency due to the absence of connections and verifications. I have other benchmarks that you might find interesting. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.